Hello and welcome to SciJoy. Today we're going to explore different types of encoders. When we programmed the Lego robot, we told the motor to turn a certain number of rotations. Motors on their own have no way of determining how far they've turned. Devices called encoders monitor the position of motors and other pieces of equipment. When I wanted to visually determine the number of rotations, I put a piece of tape on the wheel. An encoder wheel is similar to this setup, but instead of using tape, we can cut a slit out of a circle and attach this to the shaft of the motor. On one side of the encoder is a detector, and on the other, we place an emitter. The detector can only register a signal when it's lined up with the slit. Examples would be using an LED emitting light on one side and an LDR on the other, or a Hall effect on one side and a magnet on another, or a brake beam sensor. And we chose to use a brake beam sensor because we wanted to look at something new. And this side emits infrared light, and this one detects it. And it's just like the safety sensors used on your garage doors. And as the motor turns, the brake beam will read broken and unbroken. And broken will be a 0, and unbroken will be a 1. If we put the motor in different starting positions and rotate it, we can see that we get inaccurate readings if we only have one slit. This is why most encoders have many openings in them, and as these encoders turn, there's a series of pulses that looks like this. Typically, encoders are small and spin at high rates, therefore having actual slits would make them far too flimsy. Instead, they have alternating transparent and opaque areas like the encoder on this treadmill motor. We made encoders out of cardboard and 3D printed material. The 3D printed models, the templates, the wiring diagrams, the code, and the parts list for all of these encoders are in the description below. And in this serial monitor, we can see a graph of pulses. This encoder has 12 steps, and for each 12 steps counted, we say it's incremented one rotation. And that's why these types of encoders are called incremental encoders. This type of encoder can only tell you the number of rotations, and it cannot output the direction that the device or the motor is turning. To do this, we need to add another detector and another layer to the encoder, and this is offset by 90 degrees. Often this is called an A track, and this is called the B track. By knowing which track is leading and which track is trailing, you can tell the direction of rotation. If track A goes from broken to unbroken, and track B is still broken, then the encoder is turning clockwise. If track A goes from broken to unbroken and track B remains unbroken, then the encoder is spinning counterclockwise. What if you wanted to more accurately determine the position of your encoder? The brake beam can only read unbroken and broken. It cannot tell a broken section on this half of the encoder from this one. So with a brake beam, we can only split it into two halves, a broken section and an unbroken section. If we add another brake beam on top of the first one, we can make a new layer on the encoder, and we now have four different sections that we can define as 00, 01, 11, and 10. This looks familiar from our analog to digital converter videos. The disc has an infinite number of positions that it can be in, and from the analog to digital converter videos, we know that we can take a continuous signal and place it into a number of buckets. And the more bits that we use, the more options for buckets that we have. We're taking the position on the wheel and doing the same thing. The more sensors we stack up, the more bit combinations we have to work with. And the resolution or number of buckets we have is just 2 raised to the number of sensors. We use 2 because the sensor only has 2 options, a 1 or a 0. We 3D printed a 3-bit encoder, which means we have 8 options for positions. Even if you use a computer-aided drafting software, your project may not turn out perfectly aligned, especially if you use hot glue to attach the pieces. This means your readings may be a little bit off. The outermost sensor might be in the 45-degree section, while the innermost sensor is at the 90-degree section. This is going to give you an incorrect reading. So instead of ordering the broken and unbroken sections in the order that a binary number system would typically be written in, we can use Gray's code as a sort of data validation. Gray's code groups the broken and unbroken sections together as opposed to having them all spread out. With Gray's setup, your sensor shouldn't read broken, unbroken, and broken, and if it does, you probably have a slight misalignment, and you can solve this in your code. So to recap, we have incremental encoders that alternate their steps, and you can keep track of the number of rotations. We have quadrature encoders that have 2 tracks, and they can tell us how many rotations you've moved and which direction the encoder is traveling. We have absolute encoders that tell us the position of a device, and the more bits or sensors they have, the more locations you'll know. And Gray's code is a sort of data validation that we can use. So what are some other types of methods we can use for looking up position? If you have any questions or comments, you can leave them down below. You can reach us on any of these social media platforms. You can support us at patreon.com/scijoy. And remember, keep exploring.